Welcome aboard the Falcon X. While en route to your mission zone, please take a moment to familiarize yourself with the ship controls. We will be arriving shortly. This is Cyber City. Be careful, Captain. The Syndicate controls the airspace in sectors R4 and Beta 9. Safe transport of the package is vital to mission success. Good luck.
Hi, this is Ryan Thomas with EastWest, and I want to welcome you to a special edition of our Scoring with Opus series, in which we'll be demonstrating how to use EastWest ComposerCloud, which includes the new Hollywood Orchestra Opus Edition, to score a scene from a video game that comes complete with its own sound design. And that's significant because sound design plays such a huge role in the video game experience, and the music really has to work around it and sound good in context. So in this video, we'll be discussing the general ethos behind the decisions that were made in scoring this scene, and we'll also be talking about the more production-oriented details. So we have a lot to cover. Let's begin. And the music for this opening scene is basically going to be menu music, because the player is choosing the ship that they want to use. And the music needs to be able to be looped somewhat seamlessly, so because of that, you're not going to notice a lot of melodic content. So let's go ahead and give it a listen. Okay, let's go ahead and stop there and break everything down. I am going to mute the sound design track while we do this so that you can hear these instruments in isolation. So let's see what's going on in the strings. And we just have the celli playing this very simple ostinato line. We're using the mod speed patch for this, and the CC1 value is set all the way to 0, so it's going to be triggering the shortest articulation in this patch. And then the celli are going to be joined by the violins and the violas. We're just using the key switch patches for this chord progression. And I am using the 18 violins for this part because they just have this really nice, full, and lush sound. So let's see how these sound. And that's all there is to that. Let's move on to our woodwinds. And we don't have too much going on here except for just some pre-programmed runs from Symphonic Orchestra that are going to transition us into this next section. That's fairly self-explanatory. So let's add our harp as well as the orchestral percussion. And the timpani is going to play a fairly significant role, just giving us some rhythm in this section. Let's give it a listen. So we have that simple swell along with the timpani swell that are going to be joining the harp and the woodwinds to give us that transition to the next phrase. And then finally, let's add the sound design and synthesizers. So you have this brushed percussion from Storm Drum 2, which has been really heavily modified using the volume envelopes. I basically wanted this to sound somewhat synthetic, and you can see all the settings here if you are interested in replicating that. We also have some percussion from the Booyah kit in Goliath. And then we have a repeating bass synthesizer, which is basically going to act to fatten up that cello ostinato line. Let's go ahead and give it a listen. So again, all we really needed here was just some light underscore that could be easily looped. And I opted for a hybrid orchestral approach because obviously this is kind of a futuristic video game, so I wanted to have the synth elements as well as the orchestral elements. So let's go ahead and move on to the next section. And we'll take it one bar out so that you can get the transition.
Welcome aboard the Falcon X. While en route to your mission zone, please take a moment to familiarize yourself with the ship controls. We will be arriving shortly.
So for this part, I just wanted something that flowed really naturally from the previous section. And of course, we want to give the player this sense of adventure. And we're bringing in the full string section here. So you have the basses just pulsing on these quarter notes, and the celli are going to be playing the same ostinato line that they were playing in the previous phrase. And I should point out that if we had the basses playing the same line that the celli were playing, but an octave below, it would just sound a little bit too muddy. So we just want those on the quarter notes rather than the eighth notes. And then you've got violin one and two, as well as viola, just playing this chord progression. And notice how in measures five and six, we have these closed chord voicings, and then they open up in measures seven and eight. That's a really great way to build a section like this. And right there, the brass, as well as the guitar, are actually going to be providing that chord structure, so we don't really need that in the strings at this point. So let's go ahead and add the brass. And we're starting off with just a single French horn melody, and then we bring in the full brass section for the second half of this phrase. And we're doing a lot of key switch manipulation to achieve that realism. Of course, if you didn't have the French horn, for example, switching between sustain articulations and the staccatissimo articulations, it would just sound like mush and it would sound very synthetic. So it's absolutely essential to manipulate, of course, CC1 and CC11, and to also make sure that your articulations are the appropriate articulations for the note. So let's actually listen to this again, but this time we'll be in the articulation matrix view so that you can see those changes happening in real time. And let's listen to just how much realism is lost when I just set all of these to sustain. So as you can hear, the key switch manipulation here is absolutely key to achieving that level of realism. And I should point out that I'm just using the factory EastWest articulation sets for Logic Pro. Next, let's add the woodwinds. And we just have some pre-scripted runs from symphonic orchestra. So let's also add the harp. And the harp and the woodwinds are basically going to be giving us a little bit of separation in between the two parts of this phrase. So, you know, we talk about musical phrasing. Think of this kind of like a comma. And I should point out that for that harp gliss, we are using the gliss technique articulation, which I think is really important to use when you are writing your own harp glisses. All right, now let's include the orchestral percussion, and we just have the timpani playing this very simple rhythm here. And let's also throw in the epic percussion. Now, this Dynasty Odaiko is basically playing the role of a sub boom because we have this really extreme EQ filter, and it sounds like this by itself. So that's all that's going on there. And let's also include the sound design and synths. And the only thing we're doing differently in this phrase is we've added a kick drum from the 508 kit in Goliath. So let's see what all this sounds like together. Fairly self-explanatory. Now let's add the guitars. And I just wanted something to fill out the second half of this phrase And the Gibson lead from Ministry of Rock 2 was a really great way to do that. So here is everything together. So that guitar can be a really great way to fatten up a section that might need just a little bit more meat, and they blend really well with the orchestral elements. And I'm using the moderate vibrato articulation. You could see the key switch that was active in that patch. All right, let's go ahead and check out the next section. And in this scene, you've got this beautiful wide shot of the city, followed by this flyover shot. And because this is a cinematic scene, I think you can afford to have more fun with the music, make it a bit more thematic. And let's start one bar out so that you can get the cymbal swell going into this section.
We will be arriving shortly. This is Cyber City. Be careful, Captain. The Syndicate controls the airspace in sectors R4 and Beta 9. Safe transport of the package is vital to mission success. Good luck.
And this scene was actually kind of difficult to write for because the temptation is to just write something that's very inspiring and majestic because you want to match those visuals. You know, you've got this beautiful, cool shot of this futuristic city. However, the ship's AI is informing you that the Syndicate, which in this context we're assuming to be bad, controls a lot of the airspace. So you need something to bring about this ominous emotion and add a little bit of tension. And so we're going to do that, number one, by avoiding very well-defined triads. So you're not going to find a lot of well-defined major or minor chords, because of course a minor chord, if it's just a triad, it just sounds sad. And a major chord, if it's a major triad, it just sounds happy, right? You don't get a lot of nuance in those chords, emotionally speaking. So to achieve that tension that we need for this scene, we're going to use a lot of suspensions. We're going to use a lot of chord extensions. So let's analyze this starting with the strings. So we've got violin 1 and 2 playing this line in octaves with each other. And then the violas are just going to continue that ostinato pattern from before, but they're going to be on a different note. And the celli and the basses are going to be playing this ascending bass line. And then everything transitions to staccato, except for violins 1 and 2, which are going to be playing this melody here with the brass. So that's fairly self-explanatory. I just want to point out that I am using CC1 to actually program in an accent on a legato patch. And of course, you can use accented patches, you can use marcato patches. Most of the time, I actually just prefer to program in the accent using the mod wheel. Now, the brass section is just going to be playing these big, lush chords at the beginning. And then by bar 14, you'll notice that the inversion and the voicing starts to sound a little bit awkward. And that's intentional because remember that we did want to introduce some tension in this scene. And then the trumpets come in on beat 2 of bar 14, just playing this little melody line here. And then by bar 16, you've got the trumpets and French horn 1 playing this melody along with violins 1 and 2. You've got French horns 2 and 3 playing these chords. And then the trombones and the tuba are going to be playing these staccato notes along with the strings. And I should point out that for the trombones, I am using the new 2 trombones patch from Hollywood Orchestra Opus Edition. I think it's one of the best additions to the library. Such a great patch. So here's everything together. Yeah, so I think Hollywood brass really shines in that section. Let's check out what's going on in the woodwinds. And we do have some content here in the Hollywood Orchestrator preset patch. We're using the Winds Staccatissimo Unisono preset. I haven't changed anything. This is just the way that it comes loaded. And these are going to be doubling violin one on that legato line. But of course, instead of playing legato, these are playing staccatissimo because I just wanted to add some additional texture to that line. And then at 16, they are going to be playing those staccato chords along with the strings and brass. So let's hear what it all sounds like. And then I did just want to solo the woodwinds so that you could hear them in isolation, so that you can hear what the Hollywood Orchestrator preset sounds like by itself. Now let's actually talk about how we programmed that run at the end, because there are a few specific tips and techniques that I like to use to maximize realism in my orchestral runs. And I like to use a combination of playable runs patches and pre-recorded runs, both from symphonic orchestra and Hollywood orchestral woodwinds. So in this case, we're starting the runoff in the flute key switch patch using the legato slur runs articulation, but then we're finishing the run with a flute, clarinet, and piccolo pre-recorded run from symphonic orchestra. So let's see how that sounds. So the human ear is going to be drawn to the end of that run, which is where we need to have maximal realism. So that's why I'm choosing to end that run with the pre-recorded patches in symphonic orchestra. Everything before that doesn't really matter that much because it's going to be buried in the rest of the orchestration. But of course, as those instruments ascend, the human ear is going to become more and more drawn to them. So when they get to that top of the run, that's where you need to maximize the realism. And of course, it doesn't get much more real than the actual pre-recorded runs. Now, moving on to the harp and the orchestral percussion, we have the harp and the timpani giving us this transition into measure 16. And then the snare and the timpani come in to join the rest of the orchestra on those staccato notes. So let's hear how it all sounds together. And that's all fairly self-explanatory, so let's go ahead and move on to the synths and percussion. And let's actually just solo this instrument group by itself. It's gonna sound somewhat strange in isolation. Just keep in mind that it's meant to be layered with all those other orchestral elements. So for example, you know, this bass synth here is really just there to add some grit to the double basses. And the Chinese lion drum hits are really heavily EQ'd, so just keep that in mind. This is actually the EQ settings that I'm using for this particular instrument to get that sound. So let's go ahead and give it a listen. And then in context. So we're just adding some body to those bass elements, and of course we're adding some filtered percussion as well. Finally, we've got this guitar that's going to be joining the strings and the trumpets on that melody line. So that's what it sounds like by itself, and then in context. So yeah, there's a lot of layering going on, and you definitely need that for these hybrid orchestral soundtracks. Let's go ahead and move on to the next section. And let's take it one bar out so that you can get the transition.
Success. Good luck.
All right, let's stop there. Now, This is the actual gameplay portion of the soundtrack, and because this is a flying game, it's very exciting, there's a lot going on, it's very fast, I wanted the music to be pretty exciting here. So let's go ahead and just break it down, starting with strings. And we've got the violas playing this very simple ostinato line again, and the celli are playing this pattern with the basses sort of doing this call and response. And then the violins are going to be playing these runs, and then this little legato passage leading up to measure 24. So let's give it a listen. So nothing too complicated going on there. Again, I do want to point out that I just opted to program those accents just using the mod wheel. And then in the brass, we have the French horns and the low brass playing that same pattern that the celli and the basses are playing. And then they're all joined by the full brass section at 21. And then that pattern just repeats from 22 to 23. So we have some interesting chord colors coming in at measure 23, just to add to that sense of urgency. And the writing for the woodwinds here is fairly simple, but it's very important to this part of the piece. So you've got the bassoons and the bass clarinet that are going to be doubling the celli and the basses. And I should note that I'm using the 3 bassoon patch, which is new with Hollywood Orchestra Opus Edition, because I needed a bassoon section here. And then the flutes and clarinets are going to be doubling the violins on those runs at measure 21. Let's give it a listen. And of course, I'm using that technique with the runs where we start off the run using the playable runs patches, and then we end it with a pre-recorded run. So let's go ahead and move on to our harp and orchestral percussion. And there's not much harp content here. You just have these glisses that are being layered with those woodwind and string runs. But then in the snare, you have these hits that are accenting those brass and string stabs. So this is what the snare is doing. So we have that little roll before the hit. And then the crash is actually adding quite a bit here. I'm going to get to the timpani in just a minute. So I'm using a combination of muted crashes and then an open crash. And in context. And the crash is very significant here because it's going to be one of the few elements that can actually cut through the video game's sound design and be heard audibly by the player. And of course, for this section, we wanted to suggest that it's very exciting, but that there's also some danger. And the crash is a really great way to elicit those emotions. And then finally, I'm using timpani to add some tension to bars 21 and 23. And I'm using this flam that goes into a roll for both of those bars. Here it is in isolation. And then here it is in context. So don't neglect your percussion. You can add a ton of color with it, and for parts like this, it's absolutely essential. And now we're into the next phrase, so let's take it one bar out again so that you can get the transition. And as you can hear, there's some cool stuff going on in the sound design track. You've got those cars that are whooshing by. So you need to be sensitive to that. And we have some pretty interesting parts here in the strings, some dissonances, and a lot of it isn't going to make too much sense until we add the brass. So you have violins 1 and 2, as well as the celli on this moving staccato line here. And they also hold out these notes on beat 4 of measure 24, as well as beat 4 of measure 25. And then you have the violas that are actually going to be doubling French horn 1 and 2, helping to define this chord. And then the basses are just going to be playing these accents underneath everything. So let's give it a listen. Okay, so you heard that. Let's go ahead and just add the brass. And we have the trumpets and the French horns on these chords with the trombones and the tubas playing those bass accents along with the string basses. So let's hear everything together. Yeah, so it makes a lot more sense once you add the brass there and you fill out those chords. And I just wanted this section to feel kind of chaotic and very exciting and just a little bit dangerous. Now, one thing I wanted to point out is that we are doing some key switching here in the brass because I wanted a da, 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 da. And to get that da, 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 we're going from the marcato to the staccatissimo. And you can see that when I select the note. I'm gonna use the two French horn track here. That's the marcato short. But then this note here is the staccatissimo. So that's very important to achieve that realism and to get those interesting articulations. Okay, let's move on to the woodwinds. And let's listen to just the woodwind bus by itself for right now, because there is some content here that you would probably lose if we had it in the context of the brass and the strings. Now, the oboe is just going to be doubling the violin and cello line, and the bassoon and bass clarinet are just going to be doubling the string basses. But then the flutes and the clarinets are going to come in with this interesting little counter melody line that starts off with a trill. And then these two notes here are going to be staccato. And then it goes to another trill. And then that goes into a run down into measure 27. So let's give it a listen. And then let's hear it in context. So that little woodwind counter melody is just there to add some additional color and contribute to that kind of sense of danger and excitement. And now we're adding the harp and the tuned percussion. And as you can see, the harp isn't really doing a whole lot here. It's playing these glisses and just kind of filling some space in the background. But then we have the glockenspiel, which I think plays a really significant role here. And it's going to help the chords that the brass section and the violas are playing to just pop out a little bit more and give those chords more definition. And then we have the orchestral chimes coming in for the second half of this phrase, and they just add such a cool vibe and color. Listen for that change as we play through this. And you have to be careful when working with orchestral chimes not to overwrite for them, because they have such a huge presence and they're going to reverberate. If you noticed, I didn't actually have them playing that same line that the brass and the violas were playing exactly. I only have them on certain notes of that line. So let's look at the MIDI data again and we'll play through it. So again, we only have the chimes on certain parts of that line because we wanted the presence, but we didn't want the chimes to overwhelm the rest of the orchestra. Now for the orchestral percussion, we mostly just have some cymbal rolls, and then we have this crash happening on beat 3 of measure 25, and then the snare and the bass drum are both going to be accenting those orchestra hits with a little bit of a snare roll going into some of those. So that's all there is to that section. Let's go ahead and move on to the next. And here, we just want to give the player a little bit of a break before we launch into the victory music. So here it is. Okay, let's take a look at what's happening in the strings. And you just have the celli playing this very simple ostinato line with the basses playing on these accents here. And then violins and violas are going to be playing this staccato line over top of the celli and the basses. Then at measure 29, you have the violins playing this melody line with the French horns. And then at measure 30, all the strings except for violin 1 and 2 drop out. Violins 1 and 2 are going to be playing this trill while the trumpets play their line. And then at measure 21, all the strings come in. And you've got the violas and the celli on these tremolo notes here. And then you have the celli and the basses just on these sustains here. And of course, the violins are going to be playing this run into measure 32 with the violas, celli, and the basses playing these staccato notes to finish us out. Now let's go ahead and give it a listen. Nothing too complicated. We're just switching up the articulations here and there. Let's go ahead and check out the brass. And you just have the trombones and the tuba doubling the string basses up until measure 29 when the French horns come in to play this line with the violins. Then at measure 30, the trumpets come in to play this melody here. And at 31, you have the whole brass section coming in. So here it is together with the strings. Again, nothing too complicated other than some key switch manipulation. Let's move on to the woodwinds. And we have some really fun woodwind parts to talk about. So we've got the bassoons doubling the celli on this ostinato line here. And I am using the new 3-bassoon patch from Hollywood Orchestra Opus Edition for that. And we've got the contrabassoon that's going to be doubling the string basses on these accents here. And then you have this really cool melody in the piccolo, flute, clarinet, and oboe. And you can see that I have them written in 3 different octaves here. And then at measure 30, you've got, again, the high woodwinds, so flute, clarinet, and oboe playing this trill along with the violins. And you've got the bass clarinet coming in at measure 31 on this note here. And you've got bassoon 2 on these notes. And bassoon 1 on these notes here, with all the high woodwinds doing these runs along with the violins. And of course, you know that I like to finish off those programmed runs with the pre-recorded runs, which in this case are the flute and the piccolo pre-recorded runs. So altogether, it sounds like this. So again, in most cases, you're just going to get a little bit more realism out of your runs when you combine them with the pre-recorded runs from symphonic orchestra and Hollywood orchestra. Now, one other thing I should point out is that I am programming in some accents at certain parts in the run, because a player is naturally going to accent certain parts of a run, especially at the beginning. And I'm doing the same thing, of course, in the violins as well. And I'm using the legato slur runs articulations for both the violins as well as my woodwinds. Okay, and you've got the harp just playing some glisses and filling a little bit of space in the background for measures 28 and 29. Then you've got the glockenspiel doubling both the French horns and then the trumpets on their melody lines. Then the snare is just going to be adding some rhythm at measure 29. And the timpani is going to be doubling the string basses and the low brass. Then you've just got some crashes and cymbal swells. And you've got the sustain triangle just kind of adding to the sense of excitement at measures 28 and 30. So here's everything together. Okay, so that's actually everything in terms of the compositional and MIDI programming techniques that were used to create this soundtrack. So let's very briefly talk about the reverb setup and my general mic position philosophy. And as you can see, all of my reverbs are from EastWest Spaces 2, and you can see all of the settings here, so I'm not going to take the time to go over those. But for my strings, I love the Southern California Hall string-specific impulse. For my brass, I like the Southern California Hall brass-specific impulse. And for woodwinds, I love the San Francisco Hall woodwind-specific impulse. I mostly use the Northwest Hall for percussion, including the tuned percussion, and the Abandoned Abbey is great for any instrument that really just needs this huge sense of space because you have this really nice 6-second tail. And then everything is sent, at least in some amount, to the digital Hollywood Hall. So you can see on my brass bus here where I'm sending to my brass reverb, and I'm also sending to the digital Hollywood Hall. Now, in terms of my mic position setup, I generally like to use a combination of the main mic and the close mic. And that close mic is going to give you the definition that you need to give that instrument presence in the mix. Of course, the main mic is going to give you that nice big stereo image, and it's going to place the instrument in the space that it was recorded in. And if I need it to sound even bigger, I will throw in some of the surround mic and just kind of mix that to taste. There aren't really any rules to it, so just kind of figure out what works best for your piece. And that is going to do it for this walkthrough. I want to remind you that all of the instruments and reverbs that were used to create the soundtrack are included with a ComposerCloud subscription. I hope you had a good time and enjoyed the video. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you next time.